So this evening, we'll get to hear from senior librarian Mazelan Anuar, who share with us on National Library's newspaper collection and services. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mazelan Anuar.
So this is basically based on the survey done by Patricia Lim. According to her research, she had identified more than 300 newspaper titles published in Singapore since 1824. It's possible that some of these were not published because in the entry in this book, some were not indicated as being in any library's holdings. So as you can see, the majority of the titles were actually Chinese titles. Many of these were short-lived, but there are also important titles such as Lat Pao that are in our microfilm collection and also in the collection of NUS Chinese Library. Okay. So most of the English newspapers would be at British Library, and the Malay ones would be at the Malaysian institutions. This would be at University Malaya, the Malaysian archives, and I mentioned the Chinese one as being in NUS Library. So for National Library, we do have gaps in our collection. So as much as possible, we want to be comprehensive in our collection. For those titles that are not in our holdings, what we do is that we will try to purchase the microfilm copy in the past. And in the future, and at present, we are trying to get the digital copies from the other institutions. So these are some of the early English newspapers. I think most of you would be aware that the first newspaper published in Singapore would be the Singapore Chronicle. In 1823, the son-in-law of William Farquhar, his name is Francis James Bernard, or Bernard, I'm not too sure. So he made an application to start a commercial newspaper in Singapore. So that same year, in 1823, in British India, there was this, an ordinance that was enacted that require a news press in British India to request, or rather to get a license. Before they can start or even publish any newspaper. So that was essentially to control the newspapers in India because they were quite critical of the British rule back then. So, but because the Straits Settlements in Singapore and Malaya were also under the British India government, so the Ordinance, the Act, also applied to Singapore. But the application by Bernard was successful. So the license was issued, and in 1st January 1824, on 1st January 1824, the first issue of Singapore Chronicle was published. Okay. But for Bernard, he was the first editor. What happened is that within a short period of time, he had a fallout with the resident, who was John Crawford. So he was made to leave as editor, and essentially it became John Crawford's mouthpiece. So he was the main contributor. He would also censor certain news. And it was more like a sort of a semi-official government gazette back then. Okay, so I mentioned about censorship. So I've not seen any issue with this blank space, black space on any of the articles. So apparently, according to Charles Barkley, this was the earlier issues. So unfortunately, in our collection, we only have the issues from 1831. Okay. So, but we are working with British Library we are looking at making the earlier issues available in our collection. Hopefully, we'll be able to upload to Newspaper SG. Maybe not so soon. Hopefully, next year or the year after next. Okay. In 1835, the requirement to apply for the license, it was repealed. So in 1835, there's a new Press Act. So with that, the Singapore Free Press was established. Okay. So between 1824 to 1835, there was only one newspaper. So it was only after the new Press Act was enacted, then the second English newspaper was established in Singapore. So aptly, it was known as the Singapore Free Press. Okay. With the Singapore Free Press, with the fierce competition, Singapore Chronicle could not cope. And within 2 years, the Singapore Chronicle folded. So Singapore Free Press became the only paper for a short while. But in 1845, the Straits Times was established. So the first editor is Robert Carr Woods. The only reason I'm mentioning him is because for whatever reason, he had this running battle with James Brooke, the White Raja of Sarawak. So he hated his guts for whatever reason. So he has this campaign, sort of like a smear campaign, saying that James Brooke massacred peaceful traders instead of the Dayak pirates in 1849. So there were commission of inquiry that took place against James Brooke, but he was found not guilty. So this was much later in 1854. So yeah, I think in today's context, it's like maybe Robert Carr Woods would be seen as a troll spreading fake news. Yeah, so I think it's quite interesting that some things don't change. Yeah. So for the early Malay newspapers, the first published newspaper, the first Malay newspaper published in Singapore was the Jawi Peranakan. Jawi Peranakan basically means Malay of mixed parentage. This would tend to be the Indian Muslims or the Arab Muslims. So in 1907, Utusan Melayu under the Singapore Free Press was established. So Yunus Abdullah, if you know Yunus Crescent, you know MRT Station, it was named after him. So he was the first editor. And he has been dubbed as the father of Malay journalism. But he was also, he used the newspaper as his vehicle to spread his ideas. So he was the first to talk about Malay consciousness, what is Malayness, the concept of bangsa, you know, Malay nation. So, and he also started the Malay Union, which was the precursor to UMNO, now as we know it. So the Malay Union was a quasi-political organisation. Then subsequently, there were other Malay unions in other parts of Malaya. And eventually, just before the world, after World War, then they became the UMNO organisation. So the first version of Utusan Melayu, I think it was only up to 1918, if I'm not mistaken. But it inspired other Malay journalists and also entrepreneurs to start Malay newspapers. So in 1939, there is a second version of Utusan Melayu. The spelling is slightly different. The first one was spelled with M-A-L-A-Y-U, and the second one is spelled with the E instead of A after the M. So among those that were involved in the second edition or the second reincarnation of Utusan Melayu was Yusof Ishak, who subsequently became the president of Singapore. Okay, and the reason Utusan Melayu was established in 1939 was because there were dissatisfaction with the Jawi Peranakan community. I mentioned this, but they were saying that the Jawi Peranakan community, as a social leader who represented the Malay in the Legislative Council, did not really take care or try to elevate the social well-being of the Malays. Okay, so there was quite a bit of political tensions between the two parties, between those who considered themselves as pure Malay and also those who were deemed as mixed Malay, okay, the Jawi Peranakans. So for Chinese newspapers, it is possible that Lat Pao may not be the first newspaper, a Chinese newspaper published in Singapore. According to Patricia Lim, there were two other papers. Let me try to find the name. Sorry, yeah. It's called Di Fang Ribao and Risheng. Okay, maybe I did not pronounce that correctly. But supposedly, these two were published even earlier than Lat Pao. But as far as I know, there are no library with holding any issues of these two newspapers. So for Lat Pao, what happened is that it also, I mean, despite it not being the first, but it was also a very important paper. It was the longest running Chinese newspapers before the pre-World War II. Okay, it ran for 52 years. So unfortunately, the National Library do not have this collection. What we do have would be the microfilm version, the microfilm copy. But Chinese Library of NUS would have Lat Pao, okay? And they have also digitized Lat Pao. I think if you just Google NUS Library Lat Pao digital, you'll be brought to a portal whereby they have also digitize other important Chinese papers as well, apart from Lat Pao. Okay, I think about 7 or 8 titles altogether. Okay. For the National Library, one of the longest running newspapers that we have in our collection would be the Nanyang Siang Pao. So this was first published in 1923 and ran up till 1983, until it merged with Sinchu Jitpo. To become Lianhe Zaobao today, okay? So we have both papers, and we have completed digitizing Nanyang Siang Pao up to 1923, and currently we are trying to digitize Sinchu Jitpo as well. So far we have managed to digitize up to 1979, if I'm not mistaken. The problem with Chinese newspaper is much more harder to digitize compared to a Roman script or English newspapers. From our experience, what we notice is that there is no consistent in the layout. Sometimes the writing would be from left to right, sometimes from right to left, and then sometimes it would be from top to bottom, vertically. So yeah, so it's quite difficult to figure out the article and also to do the cropping for the zoning of articles. So it would take a longer time compared to English papers. Then we have the Tamil newspapers. Singai Nisan apparently is the first Tamil newspapers to be published in Singapore in 1887. And there were other smaller papers between 1932 to 1887. But we know that Tamil Murasu, since it was first published in 1932, has remained in publication even up till today. So similarly for the Tamil newspapers, just like the Chinese and the Malay newspapers, they would represent the interests of their community. Okay, I forgot to mention the Straits Chinese paper actually. So I put it under early Malay newspapers. So these are the target audience would be the Baba Peranakan. Bintang Timur and the Straits Chinese Herald, they were first published in 1894. The target audience would be Baba Peranakan, and the interesting thing is that they would use the Roman script So for the Malay newspapers, in the late 1800s, would use the Jawi script. But for the Chinese, straight Chinese papers, they would use the Roman script. Yeah, so it's actually easier to digitize and easier to locate information for the Baba papers. Okay, so now I've come to the part where what are the resources that you can use? So apart from a microfilm and the digital copy from Newspaper SG, we also subscribe to commercial databases. Okay, so if you go to our e-resources page, that will be the URL, and you go by type and by e-newspapers, so you see a list of databases that you can use to locate news information. So for current and business news, you can use Press Reader. So this would be a full digital replicas with keyword search. So you will see the newspaper as in its printed format. Okay, but the bonus is that you are able to do keyword search. So you'll be able to locate the information easily in Press Reader. Normally, the range, date range is quite short. Typically, it's only for 1 week, and some papers would be for a month. There are also occasionally papers, publishers that allow the papers to be in Press Reader for up to a year. But it really depending on the arrangement that the vendor, the supplier have with the publishers. Okay, but for Singapore newspapers, it's basically now Singapore Press Holdings. So it's only up to 7 days only. Okay. If you are looking at other international papers, you'll be glad to know that there are actually 100 countries. More than 100 countries are covered in Press Reader. Okay. So we also have Factiva. Factiva is text-based, so you won't see the layout of the newspaper. You will only see the content, but it will allow you to do keyword search and locate the information easily. The good thing about Factiva is that it has over 30,000 sources. So basically, it's a very powerful database. It's not only current papers, it also goes back to a couple of decades. For Singapore newspapers, Straits Times and Business Times, you can find articles that were published in the late 1980s. Yeah, in Factiva. Okay. But there is a slight restriction for Singapore newspapers. If you try to access it off-site, you'll be able to locate 30-day archive materials from other international papers, but not Singapore papers. Singapore papers, the arrangement Factiva have with SPH is that users can only access at the library. Bloomberg. Yes, this is more for business and financial information database. It's a very powerful database. I think it's the leading, if not the best, such database. It's extremely popular with those that deal with buying and selling stocks and shares. It provides real-time news. So this service is available at Level 7 at the National Library. We have the terminal there. You would need to register, and you have to take your turn. I think you are given only about 1 hour to use the database. I believe we could be one of the few public libraries or institutions that provide Bloomberg for our users for free. Okay, so please use them. So there's also one more database, ProQuest News 10. There are almost 2,000 newspapers in there. Coverage is similar to Factiva as well, 1980s to present. But like I say, it's slightly less sources. Factiva had 33,000, if you recall. You can actually access Straits Times from ProQuest Newsstand. And unlike Factiva, you can access the Straits Times content offsite. Okay? So there's a slight variation in terms of access between ProQuest and Factiva. But Factiva would have other SPH newspapers. ProQuest would only have Straits Times newspaper. So for past papers, yes. So we have the newspapers on microfilm collection. We have over 20, close to 25,000 microfilm reels, covering more than 220 titles from Singapore as well as Southeast Asia. Like I mentioned just now, Patricia Lim identified more than 300 newspaper titles. So there are still gaps in our collection, but we are trying to close that gap. So the service is provided at level 11 of this building. So there are, let me see, 11 microfilm readers altogether. Okay. It's quite tedious to use microfilm unless you know where to locate the information, if you know the date, the page. If not, you'll take a long time having to read and browse through the long reel of newspapers. I think one microfilm reel typically can hold at least 1,000 page. So you can imagine going through 1,000 page of newspaper issues to try and locate certain information. Okay, but I think some people do enjoy using the microfilm. We do have regulars at the reading room that we see almost every day using our microfilm collection. Yeah, maybe it's therapeutic, I don't know. Yeah. So we know that it's quite difficult to use microfilm, especially the younger generations. They have no patience. They want to do keyword search and they want to locate the information easily. So what we have done is we have started this portal called Newspaper SG. It was launched in 2010. So it started with only a handful of titles. Now we have digitized more than 43 titles. But we still have a long way to go. But ideally, we want to digitize everything. But that might not be possible because the funds might not be permitting. So we have prioritized the more significant ones. So you have the Straits Times in there, Singapore Chronicle, then what else? Singapore Free Press that we have digitized. Every year we try to push out new content. So currently, the date coverage will be from 1831 to 2014. So hopefully the collection will grow. Currently we have more than 5 million pages and we have digitized more than 185,000 issues. Okay, so every year we try to push out new content. So last year we managed to push out 5 new titles. This would include Malaya Tribune, Indian Daily Mail, Malaya Tribune, Singapore Standard, and of course the Japanese occupation newspaper, Shonan Times. So when the Japanese managed to capture Singapore, they occupy the Straits Times office and they used that to publish the Shonan Times. It was slightly, what do you call it? I don't know, they couldn't make up their mind. So initially, it was the first issue, it was known as Shonan Times. And then a few days later, they changed the name to Shonan Times with a Y instead of a H. And then much later, they changed it to Shonan Shimbun. So it's the same paper, but it's known by many names and slightly different spelling. Okay? So it's an English newspaper. I suppose because they use a Straits Times office, so they use the same equipment. There is an interesting article that has been written by our Liberian, Mei Yi. It's published in our magazine called BiblioAsia. So if you're interested, you can just go. BiblioAsia is available online. You can look up the article that has been written by our librarian. Okay. So this is just a summary of how you can access Singapore newspapers. The different format, we have microfilm. Then we also have newspaper SD, which is very useful for doing historical research. Then we have Factiva, Presidio, and ProQuest. The thing is that each database or each format would have its own restrictions. So I know it's frustrating for some people when they are informed that anything from 1990 onwards from Singapore Press holding content, they have to access it on site at the library. But that is the arrangement we have with Singapore Press Holdings, and we have to respect their wishes because the content belongs to them. Okay. But you would still be able to see certain up to 50 words, the extract of an article up to 50 words, and I suppose from there you can gauge whether you are interested in getting the article or not, whether it's worthwhile to make your way down to a library and use our multimedia station to access the articles. Okay. So this is basically old news and new use. So who use them and why would they do that? I think basically the majority of the users would be the national librarians themselves. Okay. We also have researchers like Dr. Yan, and we have students and of course members of public. Then these are our products. Singapore Infopedia, History SG, and BiblioAsia. I think some of you or most of you would be familiar with these products. Singapore Infopedia is basically like an encyclopedia on Singapore. So what happened is that the librarians and also other library staff would populate content into this portal, and it will be based on the resources available in the National Library. So the content in there would tend to be of interest to Singapore or related to Singapore. Okay, then History SG is something akin to Today in History. So this would be articles on events that are deemed significant or important in Singapore's history. Okay, then similarly we have BiblioAsia. These are basically products that we want to highlight our resources, what we have in our collection, to publicize to members of public, to our users and readers. So we hope that by reading the articles, they would be interested to come down to the library or even use our portals to find out more for themselves, okay, on certain topics. So I mentioned students. So for the National Library, we have a team from engagement that would go out and engage students. They want students to use our resources. So they would approach schools to have programs, literacy programs. And also, we are working with MOE. To see how we can support their curriculum. I think for most of our resources, for history and social studies, the students find the resources very useful for newspapers or even the portals that we have, like History SG and so on. So, yep, so we know that students do use our resources. And these are just some feedback that we receive from members of public when we launch a newspaper SG. So many of them express their delight that they no longer have to use the microfilm. Okay, so they are quite happy that they can now just do keyword search rather than having to sit at the microfilm room for a long time to try locate an information. So there are also people who do family research. So they want to know more about their family history, and they were able to locate information about their grandparents, their family members. So this would be information available in passenger shipping lists, obituaries, wedding announcements, and also maybe birth announcements. So these were the kind of information that were available in the newspapers in the past. Okay? Yeah, so someone say that it certainly saved the tears and the backache from sitting through hours of scrolling through microfilms in the icy cold rooms at the library. Okay. So now I'm just going to highlight a couple of research done by Bonnie Tan was our librarian, but she has left National Library. So this was presented at the IFLA World Library Information Congress, okay, in 2013. So she's a food historian. So she was doing this food research on curry puff. Okay, then she thought it was simple, but apparently it wasn't so straightforward. So what happened is that the humble curry puff went by many names. So it's called Western puff bake, epok epok in Malay, and then Indian samosa. Okay, so this was her curry puff search tree that she realized that she has to use different search terms to try locate the history of curry puff in Singapore. So it was a really challenging and amusing anecdote that she shared because using those keywords, she would also get thrown off and distracted by variant usage of the word curry puff or even variant spelling of curry puff. So apparently where Old Chang Kee was, it was known as Kali Pap Lin. Okay, so. And then there's also different spelling, curry pop. And apparently, curry pop hairstyle was also the in thing, I don't know, sometime in 1960s maybe. Yeah. So even though when we digitize the newspapers, it helps users to locate the information, but it's sometimes they are required to rethink their strategies. Okay, they have to tweak the search strategy or the search terms that they need to use. If not, they will be bombarded by a lot of noise, information that may be interesting but not quite relevant to what they are looking for. So if you're interested in reading the full presentation of Bonnie's research, then you can go to this URL, which is quite long actually. Yeah, but maybe you can just Google Bonnie Tan curry puff IFLA. You should be able to locate the slides. Okay, so recently also we have this PhD candidate. He participated as our research fellow. His name is Kan Kan. So using our newspaper collection, he was looking at the Dutch East Indies 1926 Communist Revolt. So he was quite surprised to see that there were a lot of reports on Dutch East Indies, of communist activities in Dutch East Indies, in British Malaya. So why was that? And what something else that he realized was that most of the documents pertaining to the communist parties in Dutch East Indies and British Malaya, they did not survive after post-World War II. Possibly destroyed or possibly never kept or possibly hidden, so we are not sure. So he thought that newspapers could serve as that gap to make up for the shortage of original party documents. Okay, so yep. So he used our portal Newspaper SG, and initially he realized that for using the keyword communist or communism in 1920s, there was a spike of articles or report in 1925. So what he knew was that in 1925, the Chinese, or is it China? China Communist Party had a branch established in Singapore, or rather in Malaya, in 1925. So he thought that could be the reason that there was a spike of reports in 1925. But when he read further, when he went into the research further, So what he realized was that the reports tend to be on the activities of the Indonesian Communist Party instead. So maybe because it was newly formed, the CPC branch in British Malaya, they were not that active. But the Communist Party in Indonesia, they were more active, and they also organized a revolt in 1926. It was suppressed by the Dutch East India government quite successfully. But there were also other disruptions and unrest at other parts of Dutch East Indies. So this could be related to the Communist Party of Indonesia. It could be just attributed to this party because they simply assumed that any disruptions at that time were actually done by the Communist Party of Indonesia. So that's why there's a surge of reports in the mid-1920s. Okay. So So he was intrigued why the Malaya readers were interested in Dutch East Indies issues. So further readings, he found out that when the PKI were being suppressed by the Dutch East Indies government, many of them escaped and came to British Malaya. So that was the main worry, that these communists from Indonesia would infiltrate the society in British Malaya and Singapore. Yeah, so I guess that was one of the main reasons why there were many reports of the Indonesian Communist Party activities in Singapore newspapers. Okay. So what's next? What we know is that more and more the publishers tend to go fully digital. I think recently, since 29 September, Today Online, currently still published by MediaCorp, they have decided to do away with the print format. So they have gone fully digital. So for such papers, it's a big headache for us. You know, we have to figure out how to collect this online news content. For the mainstream papers such as Today and Channel News Asia, is not so bad. The content would still be available in Factiva. But for the non-mainstream ones like The Middle Ground, The Online Citizen, they are not available at any other newspaper portal, okay, apart from their own site. So currently, our Legal Deposit Act doesn't allow us to collect the materials from them. So we are thinking of trying to request the content if they're agreeable to allow us to collect those content. But we also have to think then how we can make the content accessible, either in our portal or in a different portal altogether. Okay. So I've mentioned this. So what we'll continue to do is to fill up our collection gaps. So we are working with British Library, and I think sooner or later we will also have to work with institutions in Malaysia, especially for the Malay papers. Then for the Chinese papers, we would also have to work with NUS because eventually, I think NUS also is having issues with how they can preserve and make the newspapers available. Because we do know that they have done away with their microfilm unit, so hopefully they will not be throwing away their old microfilm collection as well. So, yep. Then we are also looking at non-Roman newspapers, especially the Jawi newspapers and the Tamil newspapers. The problem with these non-Roman newspapers, we have not found a suitable OCR software to generate the text to allow users to do a keyword search. So we are thinking of actually transliterating or transcribing these Tamil or Jawi newspapers, and then hopefully maybe by next year or the year after next, we would be able to make the content searchable in Newspaper SG. So yeah, this is part of our plan. No promises yet lah, but this is what we plan to do. So I think next year you can look forward to an exhibition that will showcase the early advertisements of Singapore. So majority of the material would be from newspapers, advertisements that were published in newspapers in the early days. Okay, so maybe we'll see you then.
What does it take to be a librarian sourcing all the newspaper, and where do you get your funds from, the archives and even the operation of your daily work?
With regards to funds, so we would put up a case to our ministry. So if they are agreeable, we would argue that these are heritage materials that we need to preserve, we need to collect, and we need to make accessible to Singaporeans. They understand the need to do this, but we also have to understand that there are other priorities as well. So there are competing priorities. So sometimes we don't always get what we want, so we do lesser. But now we are also looking at maybe soliciting donation from other sources. Like for instance, we work with British Library to digitize the Malay manuscripts in British Library collection. The funds were actually donated from the Bollinger, the Bollingers. So that is one model that we can look at lah. To see how we can digitize more materials for National Library.
Good evening. You refer something about today's online, and then you mentioned about there is this Government Act, is it? And this Government Act does not allow other type of news, internet posting on the news, what, Citizen Online or something like that. So can we elaborate about this act? And then does all other many other countries also have such acts that are to control non-standard or non-mainstream news?
I think what I was referring to was the Legal Deposit Act. Legal Deposit Act would allow us to collect materials published in Singapore. But currently our Legal Deposit Act doesn't allow us to collect these digital materials yet. So we are looking at amending the Legal Deposit Act to also allow us to collect digital content. But with regards to the online news site, so in Singapore, I'm not sure about other countries, but in Singapore, these online news sites are required to register with IMDA. So currently, what I found out from IMDA, there are 10 such news online news sites that have registered with IMDA. So yep. So, but I think about 6 of them is actually mainstream papers. Would be from SPH, would be from MediaCorp and Channel News Asia. Yep.
Are you able to tell me what is the reason that the legal deposit act does not allow you to collect the digital from the online news entity? Do you know the reason why you are not allowed to do so?
Because the legal deposit act is basically, historically speaking, is just to collect printed documents. So we are trying to amend the act, but it's not easy to amend. So it has to go a lot of processes. This is more the responsibility of our legal team. But we are trying to amend the act to allow us, or rather to make it compulsory for publishers of digital content to submit their content to us.